Welcome to the program. I'm Aaron Dykes. This is the Infowars Nightly News. Today is Tuesday, April 24th, 2012.
Tonight, breaking news from the Infowar. The Bilderberg Group is set to meet in Virginia, May 31st to June 3rd. Is this Chantilly 3.0? Then, it looks like Ron Paul is winning states. In fact, he has the most delegates in Iowa and Minnesota. Yet the mainstream media continues its ban on Ron Paul coverage. Plus, the Obama administration announces the war on terror is over. So why do we still have the TSA, NDAA, the Patriot Act, and countless wars of aggression? And we flash back to GM corn infected with AIDS. Is it coming to a cob near you? And finally, Aaron Dykes sits down with Jurriaan Maessen. This will be a conversation with two of the most prolific writers exposing eugenics in the Northern Hemisphere. All this and more on the InfoWars Nightly News. I take you now to the InfoWars Central Texas Command Center, deep behind enemy lines, with Aaron Dykes, your host.
Tonight in news, the location of the 2012 Bilderberg meeting may have been revealed. Top researchers, including Tony Gosling, believe they've found that the location will again, for the third time, be Chantilly, Virginia, the site of Bilderberg in 2008, where Alex Jones and crew helped surround the group and rout them out. Indeed, protests against Bilderberg have been growing steadily since Alex first went to the Ottawa, Canada meeting in 2006 and the subsequent release of his powerful documentary Endgame. Of course, Jim Tucker has been the longtime sleuth of Bilderberg, covering it more than 35 years, but that was many lonely years covering it out without the help of the mainstream press and the rest of it. Now, a large portion of international press have begun to cover the meeting. Even Fox News had to cover it last year in St. Moritz, where myself and Paul Joseph Watson went to cover the meeting in Switzerland. That meeting ended early because so many protesters gathered on the hill and chased them down during one of their nature walks. They decided to turn tail. We will, of course, keep you up to date on whether or not that is a confirmed location. They are a deceptive group. They control much of the world's agenda, and they may well change hotels or locations altogether. But that would be upcoming between the dates of May 31st and June 3rd, just over a month away. Meanwhile, Ron Paul, supposedly already out of the Republican race, supposedly Mitt Romney clinching the nomination. And yet, wait, hold on. Ron Paul actually won Iowa. And so the Iowa caucus leading off the GOP primary, the one that the establishment was so afraid Ron Paul might win, that they said the Iowa caucus would be discredited and no longer count if Ron Paul won. Well, now he indeed has officially won, gaining officially a majority of those delegates. There's 28 delegates in Iowa. Ron Paul over the weekend gained at least 14. More will be chosen leading into the statewide and the national conventions. He's also has a majority of delegates in Minnesota and is likely to have a majority of delegates in as many as six or more other states, which would contest things at the GOP delegation in August. Of course, we're not saying that Ron Paul is likely to actually get the nomination, but he's showing the fraud of the process. They definitely ripped him off. They gave him improper media coverage. They blacked him out of the media, did everything to tarnish his name, then did all kinds of election politicking, fraudulent vote counting. Who knows what happened with electronic machines? Why did he not gain votes versus 2008 numbers in Nevada and on and on. Well, Ron Paul is just one front and the larger fight against the establishment. You have to engage the process to show that the process is not working while pursuing other peaceful alternatives to try to rein the system in to prevent it going to the full-scale level. So that's something to watch. But they said Ron Paul couldn't win, wouldn't win. Now, in fact, he is winning. Let's go to the clip.
Worst case scenario, Ron Paul ties for first place in Minnesota. Anything better than that, he wins outright. And it should be noted, he warned us this was going to happen.
Thank you very much.
When the dust settles, I think there's a very good chance that we're going to have the maximum number of delegates coming out of Minnesota.
Ron Paul was right. Nobody is getting more delegates than he did in Minnesota or in Iowa or in wherever else this Ron Paul delegate strategy of his pays off.
And so even though people like Santorum have dropped out of the race, there still is a contest within the GOP. I think it's important that Ron Paul supporters continue to make their presence known. Of course, we've covered on this show how he continues to have crowds of 5,000, 10,000 or more at his rallies, while the Romneys of the world have only a few hundred and they have to cut the angles a certain way so they don't show that they have giant empty sports stadiums with only a few people down on the actual field. You've also got Ron Paul advisor Doug Weed commenting on the delegation process, and of course the clip you just saw on Rachel Maddow, really the only mainstream outlet to cover it, now that they've pretty much alleged that the process is over and that it's this Obama versus Romney thing and blah, blah, blah. It's all staged elections. I have no faith in that process, but I think we still do need to demonstrate the process. That's not doublespeak. I just think it's important to pursue both, not get your hopes up that you're going to fix the system through rigged elections, but at the same time, show that a strong candidate can have certain types of successes, show where he's been shut out of the ability to actually win, which he could have done if the media backed him, gave him a fair shot like the other controlled candidates, and if the elections themselves had been fair, if there wasn't all that fudging and whatnot. Because you have to remember, first it was Romney winning Iowa by eight votes. Then a few weeks later, it was Santorum. All along, though, they had to know Ron Paul really had the delegate support, and now it's proven he has a minimum of a first-place win on the delegates for Iowa, Minnesota, and other states. Of course, Maine, one of the main states where he may have it. Meanwhile, the war on terror is over. That is, if you can believe an Obama administration official who's highlighted the fact that Obama can now safely embrace Islamists, and that activities like the Arab Spring and so forth have put a new path in the Middle East, a new way to gain popular support over there without having to fight the war against Al-Qaeda. Of course, it has everything to do with the fact that through the Libyan war and now the effort in Syria to destabilize Assad, the West has openly partnered with Al-Qaeda. There's the headlines right there. The West and Al-Qaeda on the same side. Then in Syria, Al-Qaeda and the West back the Syrian rebels, and on. It's just a fact. Now they're covering for it as they make frontline the war against the American people. They're still going to keep all the police state, all the TSA checkpoints that they're now rolling out to bus stops, train stops, eventually highway checkpoints, eventually malls. They've already breached sports stadiums with big events like the Super Bowl. That will all continue to expand because America must be kept, must be dumbed down under the larger sustainable development plan for population control in every sense. But in many ways, the Obama administration has moved away from the fearful exterior of the war on terror. Another aspect to it, though, the system may not be all intact on that point. They may not be giving up because just in the news, they're making big splashes over the supposed Al-Qaeda plot to bomb the Long Island Railway. They've got this trial with Bryant Neal Venice, an American soldier in the Army who later converted to Al-Qaeda in 2008. That's not a recipe for sheep dipping. Anyway, he supposedly wanted to bomb a Walmart and the Long Island Railroad, and now there's big fear all over the airwaves about that, even as certain Obama administration officials are saying basically the war on terror is over. Another war on the American people is in the executive power. Of course, the Constitution very succinctly lays out the balance of powers designed by the framers. The executive branch was to be co-equal with the judicial and congressional branches and checked in many other ways by the states and individuals of this country. But more and more, presidents are relying on executive power, and now Obama is officially in the headlines embracing that he too will have to use executive power because of the gridlock in Congress and the fact that so many dirty Republicans won't go along with his agenda. We can't wait, he says, and they've got all these quotes from board meetings. One Saturday last fall, President Obama interrupted a White House strategy meeting to raise an issue not on the agenda. He declared, aides recalled, that the administration needed to more aggressively use executive power to govern in the face of congressional obstructionism. Increasingly in recent months, he said, the administration's been seeking ways to act with Congress, branding its unilateral efforts, "We Can't Wait," a slogan that aides said Obama coined at the strategy meeting and continued to roll out with dozens of new policies, from jobs to veterans to drug shortages, fuel economy, and on. Obama's not saying he has a right to defy a congressional statute, said Richard Ace Pildes, a law professor at NYU. If the legislative path is blocked, he otherwise has the legal authority to issue an executive order on an issue. And they're more willing to do that more than they were 2 years ago. And it goes on to talk about how Obama's new approach is doing just that, putting him in the company of his predecessors. Mr. Bush, for example, failed to persuade Congress to pass a bill allowing religiously affiliated groups to receive taxpayer grants, then issued an executive order to make the change. That's what presidents do, said one Mr. Jack L. Goldsmith. It's taken Obama 2 years to get there, but this has happened throughout history. You can't be in that office with its enormous responsibilities. When things don't happen, you get blamed for it. And not exercising all the powers you have accrued to it over time just doesn't make sense, they basically said. Well, that's what makes it more dangerous. Not that Obama's the first to rule by executive fiat, the first to misuse executive orders to put United Nations agendas on the table through strictly the executive branch, or to try to pass an EPA ban on greenhouse gases strictly through the executive arm. It's been a gradual abuse of the executive branch that's the real danger to our country. It's been ongoing really for a long time, but especially since the days of FDR. Recall he used the phrase broad executive power. Let's roll that clip now.
I am prepared under my constitutional duty to recommend the measures that a stricken nation in the midst of a stricken world may require. But in the event that the national emergency is still critical, I shall not evade the clear course of duty that will then confront me. I shall ask the Congress for the one remaining instrument to meet the crisis: broad executive power.
Broad executive power.
Entwicklung in Amerika mit dem allergrößten positiven Interesse. Und wir sind dort der festen Überzeugung, dass Präsident Roosevelt und seine Berater auf dem richtigen Weg sind.
I believe President Roosevelt has chosen the right path. We are dealing with the greatest social problems ever known, says Joseph Goebbels, the Nazi propagandist. Millions of unemployed must get their jobs back.
Und in den Kontoren verloren haben, wieder an ihre alten Arbeitsstellen zurückzuführen.
And this cannot be left to private initiative. It is the government that must tackle this problem. So there you have it, broad executive power endorsed by none other than Nazi Joseph Goebbels back in the 30s when they were still gaining power into World War I, and when he openly applauded the efforts of President Roosevelt to seize that executive power to do what must be done for the country. The only problem is it totally opened the gates to destroying the Constitution, totally overusing the executive branch, and on and on. You know, Harry Truman, who succeeded FDR, used the phrase "the buck stops here" to describe the presidency at a time when it was increasingly untrue. More and more advisors and different departments and different administrations all under the executive branch began really running policy, both domestic and foreign, and increasingly presidents were nothing more than a puppet. They didn't decide hardly anything, and it's only gotten worse. The whole larger continuity of government program and on has largely, mostly been done under the executive branch with a little here and there from Congress. And you see that in one prominent example in the President's Council on Sustainable Development. That came in under Clinton in 1992. What is that? That's the United Nations Agenda 21 program, implemented and signed under the elder George H.W. Bush, then transferred into executive action under President Clinton, and it's still being pursued today. We've discussed very recently all the Agenda 21 things being pursued under President Obama's branch. So it's executive orders, it's executive fiat, it's agencies, it's all of it. It's all been misused. And you know what's in the President's Council on Sustainable Development? What's in the overview? It's not only sustainable communities, it's not only equity and health and the environment and supposed economic prosperity, it's not only education and international responsibility, it's population. It's population control. For the first time ever on paper, a U.S. policy for the stabilization of the U.S. population. How did we get there? Let's go back to Henry Kissinger, 1974, National Security Memorandum 200, making for the first time ever the United Nations goal of stabilizing developing world populations part of the United States foreign policy to target developing world populations as a national security objective. What happened in between? You had people like John P. Holdren, now currently in the Obama White House, telling us that we need to do this here at home. They said in Ecoscience, Holdren and Ehrlich did, the law regulates other highly personal matters. For example, no one may lawfully have more than one spouse at a time. See the reductive thinking? You have to agree to the first step, then the next. Why should the law not be able to prevent a person from having more than two children? This is 1977. It goes on from there. There's one more quote. Indeed, it has been concluded that compulsory population control laws, even including laws requiring compulsory abortion, could be sustained under the existing Constitution if the population crisis became sufficiently severe to endanger the society. So you see how they move us down the field, and now you've got the executive branch, just in one small example of the larger executive branch overreach, now dictating on paper U.S. population size. You can see what some of their goals are. That's a whole another wormhole for another day, but it ties in to the larger cashless control grid that they are pursuing. And so now we've got the CISPA bill back on the agenda. Here we have security experts sending Congress a letter on the Fourth Amendment busting CISPA. Indeed, it's an open letter from dozens of cybersecurity experts, inventors of the internet, IT professionals, and on, all saying don't do the CISPA bill and stop with these overreaching cybersecurity policies. You've also got Ron Paul saying the latest assault on internet freedom is Big Brother writ large. But you've got people like Senator John McCain and others saying, yes, we specifically need to curb civil liberties and hand over all data for the purpose of cybersecurity. Again, part of the ongoing Bilderberg agenda to legitimize the mandate for cybersecurity to put all people of the world, especially in America, under the centralized database of larger command and control. With that said, we have TSA leaving a note to tell passenger, go to hell. What happened? New Yorker Ross Berenson found that TSA had dug into, broken, and tampered with his luggage despite having a TSA-approved lock on his luggage. When he went to complain and get the form for that complaint, it had carbon copied in on multiple copies, go to hell. In other words, whoever asked for a complaint form would have that stamped on there. Nobody could give me any answers about what happened in LA, but they very politely told me if I wanted to file a complaint, I could fill out a form, Berenson told the Gothamist. However, when he filled out the form, it had the go to hell remark, just showing their attitude towards anyone complaining about their system, anyone speaking out, anyone not wanting to just submit and go along. But more submission is on the way, as we've exposed. The Big Brother transport bill is set to advance in Congress this week. Paul Joseph Watson has the report. A Big Brother transit bill that would empower the IRS to revoke passports of alleged tax delinquents and mandate the installation of black boxes in all cars, as well as a myriad of other privacy-busting measures, is set to take a huge leap forward this week and goes into the details of this terrible bill called the Moving Ahead for Progress in the 21st Century, MAP 21. Sounds very Agenda 21-esque. Other papers, such as the Investor's Business Daily, have called it a Stalinist assault on mobility rights. And indeed, that's what all dictatorships do. They keep the population under control, keep them from being able to move about freely, criticize the government, leave the country, and they have ways to mark and punish dissidents, either financially or with the rights of government, turning them into privileges and keeping people contained. But that's not all. We've got more and more on the cash ban. You heard months ago about how Louisiana had decided to ban the use of cash for secondhand purchases such as pawn shops, garage sales, on and on. Well, that's happening in Europe as well, as they deal with austerity and more under their larger economic problems. Well, the technocrats from Mario Monti in Italy to those in Spain and the others have began to clamp down on using cash for large purchases. In one case in Spain, moving down to 2,500 euros at a time, saying anything more is suspect and likely criminal in an attempt to avoid taxes. Other countries, such as in Spain, and I'm sorry, as in Italy, take that 2,500 euro mark and push it down towards 1,000 euros, saying anything more than 1,000 is now beginning to become a little bit suspicious. They have similar moves in the UK and other countries. So you can see the larger global government is beginning to move us more and more onto the cashless control grid, and cash itself is becoming more and more suspect and criminalized. That is a report from A.M. Freyed, another fine contributor to the Infowars. Moving on, I wrote a short flashback article about other GMO problems we're seeing. We've covered the gamut on how GMO crops are causing organ failures, sterility, other bizarre damage and deformities, a kind of a cloaked long-term third generation masked infertility among rats that have been tested and others in studies. Now, going back to 2002, we see another very dangerous aspect of the whole GMO movement. Flashback: escaped mutated GM maize on the loose, maybe carrying AIDS virus. Now, a lot of people misinterpreted this. I'm not saying you're literally going to contract AIDS from some piece of corn out there. What I'm trying to highlight is the fact that they're doing dangerous experimental test vaccines that they're growing in crops under this new pharmaceutical GMO crops thing that they've got going on, and how that itself is tainting other crops. It's escaped, it's gone wild, and we don't really know what the effects are. Now, pull yourself back from this article. Look at the larger picture. We know autoimmune diseases are on the rise. AIDS, or autoimmune disorder syndrome, is just one of those, of course, as we know it to be basically the worst. But you've got Crohn's and a bunch of other varieties all on the uptick without any sign of slowing down. Where did it all come from? We know we have environmental, vaccine, food factors, and on, and this may be just worsening that problem. Now, going back to 2002, you've got a company called Prodigene, because they're prodigies and such geniuses, based in A&M University in College Station here in Texas, and they got approval from the USDA to conduct more than 85 open-air trials of their pharmaceutical drugs grown in GM maize varieties, and they decided to grow them right out in the open in the Midwest in places like Iowa and Nebraska, where they were allowed to openly contaminate. And you've heard all the cases about farmers who want to grow organic, don't want the Monsanto seed, and yet they get sued because their crops are contaminated by 1% or less of Monsanto's GMO crops, and then they have to pay in court. Their whole agriculture's ruined. Well, this happened in a different context where their trials escaped admittedly tainted crops, first in Nebraska. The USDA knew about it, but they covered it up, allowed Prodigene, the geniuses of GMO, to continue doing what they're doing. And then they had another contamination case where one of their mystery viruses, which included the AIDS vaccine, a derivative for that, which included a blood clotting agent, which included a digestive enzyme that produces insulin, industrial adhesives, and on, all these bizarre experimental vaccines they're growing in GM corn, and it admittedly was not cleaned up properly and later tainted a soya crop that was planted in the same space. It led to a criminal investigation, but the company was just slapped on the wrist with a $250,000 fine. The company wasn't stopped. They've been continuing to grow to this day. Other companies like Monsanto or Dow Chemical continue to do their own experiments. But it's a lesson of how there could be open-air contamination, unexpected consequences to GMO, including in these very dangerous varieties. AIDS vaccine should raise a lot of questions, especially since many of these vaccines are known to contain the elements that cause the disease itself. Weaker strains of them, so-called attenuated strains, are used to develop vaccines, yet they are part and participle to the actual disease. And this stuff has unknown contamination levels as worldwide diseases continue to climb, as the health of Americans and other Western nations continues to decline, as globalists continue to tell us how they need to cull the population one way or another, and how we had better go along with their plans. That's the real story here. I hope you could see it for yourself. It's not that you're going to catch AIDS from eating GMO corn. It's that they're contaminating the earth recklessly, wildlessly, as Alex has often warned about. Let's turn now to our daily quote. It comes from Ron Paul. It's about his legacy of sticking to his word. I will always vote what I have promised and always vote the Constitution. As well, I will not vote for one single penny that isn't paid for, because debt is the monster. Debt is what's going to eat us up, and that is why our economy is on the brink. Ron Paul, not sure on the year of that, but he has indeed had a career-long, consistent message, and we wish him the best as he attempts to contend just the political spectrum of our ongoing operations in the U.S. as we try to restore the republic and rein in some kind of sensible government, something closely related to the Constitution, instead of the overtly Marxist world government aims they have. We'll be back after this with Jurriaan Maessen, a key researcher into the world government and eugenics model. Thanks for watching. Stay tuned. Spread the word. Infowars Nightly News.
Welcome to Infowars.com. This is Sam Vaughn reporting from Charlotte, North Carolina. In today's breaking news, an independent study conducted by the clergymen of the United States of America has released data indicating that of known and investigated satanic church locations in the United States, at least 50% are in close physical proximity to an orphanage. The implications of this are far and wide. The research states that many of the orphans seem to be affiliated with the closely located satanic church and are sponsored, in effect, by this satanic church. And quite a few go on to be policemen, judges, lawyers, local businessmen, and even some senators and congressmen.
We're going to focus tonight's broadcast on a new story that I think most of you are familiar with. The tragic death, senseless murder, of a teenage boy of color whose killer has yet to be brought to justice. And no, I'm not talking about Trayvon Martin. I'm talking about a different young man, Abdurrahman Al-Waqi. Now, this 16-year-old boy, born in Denver, Colorado, a U.S. citizen, was struck down from the sky by a Predator drone missile, or drone kill, as it's been dubbed, while at a barbecue with his cousins in Yemen last October 2011. Now, the boy's only crime, of course, was that his father, Anwar Al-Waqi, himself a U.S. citizen, he was also drone killed 2 weeks prior to that. He was suspected of being an Al-Qaeda operative, emphasis on the word suspected, never proven. In fact, no evidence was ever even presented. Both were killed as part of a secret assassination program, which became not so secret back in 2010. There's an article here from the Washington Post, written by Dana Priest.
I'm Trisha Bracken, reporting for Infowars.com. I'm here at Oaksterdam University, which was raided by the DEA and the IRS on April 2nd, along with founder Richard Lee's medical marijuana dispensary and his private home. This is contrary to President Obama's promise to respect states' rights when it comes to medical marijuana. Protesters during the raid even yelled at the agents to go home. And at a rally in San Francisco afterwards, they also yelled, "You lie, Obama," and called for an end to this federal interference in California. Though he was not charged with any crime yet, the intimidation seems to have worked on Richard Lee. He has announced that he will be giving up ownership of all of his marijuana-related businesses. The federal raid on Lee, who is a respected community member here in Oakland, is a sad example of the government's infringement of our state's rights and our personal liberty.
Info Warriors. This is Mary Ellen Moore for Infowars.com. I'm originally from Minneapolis, Minnesota, and I'm heading to Austin, Texas for my permanent move. I'm here today to try to become part of the Infowars reporter team. The world is upside down, and we have to show people how they can become awakened to what's really going on. It's a very difficult task, but how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. This is Mary Ellen Moore for Infowars.com. As many of you InfoWars listeners know, there is a banking, a medical, and a petrochemical conspiracy against the American people. This all goes back to the AMA, the American Medical Association, that was formed back in 1847. And at that time, there was only a very, very small percentage of doctors who were performing what we call heroic medicine or allopathic medicine. Most doctors were homeopathic at that time. But this club that was formed, the AMA, only allowed doctors who were practicing allopathic medicine into their private club. Around 1900, everybody's favorite robber baron, John D. Rockefeller, basically said competition was a sin, took over the entire medical profession, and turned it into the medical monopoly that we have today. The trick was how he revamped the system from a homeopathic system into an allopathic system was the key to the whole practice of what we know today as modern medicine. Rockefeller's goal was to monopolize the pharmaceutical and the petrochemical industry all into one. John D. Rockefeller's company was Standard Oil at the time. He managed to take over controlling interest in IG Farben, which was Germany's biggest drug maker. And we'll save the Hitler connection for another show. But the final alliance that John D. Rockefeller made was with J.P. Morgan and Andrew Carnegie. So you can see he already had his minions set in place with the banking industry. So the Rockefellers directly took control of all the drug companies, and then all the directors of that cancer crypt called Sloan Kettering.
Hello, Internet. My name is J.C. Barbin. Here I am at the scene of the mass GMO slave factory that we know as Walmart. As you can see, here I am walking down the food aisle, and it's important to take note that most of these food items primarily contain sugar at their core, either that or some artificial sweetener. What's even scarier is that there is a new artificial sweetener in town called Neotame. You can read the full report at Infowars.com, but Neotame is like aspartame's big daddy, which is 13,000 times sweeter than sugar and even more toxic. But the punchline here is that there is no labeling requirements for this sweetener, which means it could be in any one of these products without us knowing. So the question you're probably asking is, why does this even matter? Or why does it matter if there's sugar in all these products? Could sugar be a mass-controlling tool of the elite? Well, first we must understand what sugar does to the body. Look, let's start with a single tablespoon of sugar. It only takes a tablespoon or two to create a sugar spike in your body. Researchers from the University of California, San Francisco have found that adults consume about 8 tablespoons per day and teens 12.
Our biggest contest ever, and we're looking for people who love freedom and who want to be all in the resistance to tyrants. So you say you want to fight the New World Order. Why, if you were on the radio, if you were Alex Jones, you'd really kick some globalist ass. Well, here's your chance. We're hiring not one, but two new reporters. Whose reports are going to be on the radio, whose reports are going to be on the nightly news, who will even anchor the show. If you're ready, here's your chance to step into my shoes, and I hope you surpass what I've done. Two winners, $10,000 in prizes, and a shot to be a reporter inside the Infowars.com command center. We're looking to hire one male reporter and one female reporter. And when you win $5,000. Your video gets seen by hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people on YouTube, and you get put into the very front of the running to be hired as a reporter slash anchor right here in our operation. Do you have what it takes to be the next Info Warrior? The rules are posted below me here and at Infowars.com. This is a big deal. You know, the globalists are expanding their global empire, but at the same time, the people are waking up all over the world. We've expanded our operations in the last year. We've added the nightly news 5 nights a week. We're making more special reports. We're reaching 15 million people every week. In a year, I want that to be 30 million. This is your chance to join the team. I want to see what you can do. But a big hint is this. Can your news piece make the news? Does it get people's attention? Does it educate people? Does it open minds? That's more important than being beautiful or speaking with perfect eloquence as an orator. All of that is important. But we're looking for people that have that magic spark, that fire of liberty in their heart, because I want you to join our team. I want to give you a launch pad so you can really take off and engage the globalist. And if this works, we'll have contests all the time, and we'll continue to build this operation. I'm involved in a talent search, looking for people who have the fires of liberty burning in their hearts and their minds. You've got until April 30th to complete your news report, and then we'll announce the winners 1 week later. Are you going to join the InfoWar? Do you have what it takes? It's up to you. All serious entries will be posted on Infowars.com. So everybody wins. You're getting the message of liberty out, and that's what really matters. But in the final equation, it's not about showing Alex Jones what you got. It's about showing the world and the globalist that no army can stop an idea whose time has come. Join me in the InfoWar. So you say you want to fight the info war. You say you want to go head up against the New World Order. You can do a better job than Alex Jones. I know you can. And here's your chance to prove your mettle. Globalist eugenicist control freaks adding poison to your water and laughing as you get sick and die? Start purifying your water with ProPure. My friends, I've done a lot of research, and the best gravity filter out there, bar none, is ProPure, and it's available discounted at Infowars.com. Its filters are silver impregnated to prevent bacterial growth. There's no priming required. It's NSF 42 certified. Optional fluoride filters can reduce fluoride up to 95%. Easy to set up and use. Doesn't require electricity. Purify water from lakes, streams, ponds, and wells. This filter system leaves in beneficial minerals, which is key. Save money by not buying bottled water and avoid BPA that leaches from the plastic. ProPure is the best gravity-fed filter out there. It's what my family uses. Infowars.com already has the lowest price on ProPure. But if you add the promo code WATER at checkout, you get an additional 10% off at Infowars.com. You can also call to order 888-253-3139.
You ready? Thank you, Fred. Thank you. All right, let me gain myself. That threw me off slightly. I was almost ready. I'm Aaron Dykes. This is the InfoWars Nightly News, and we are back from break. We're joined now by a researcher who's become one of our main contributors as well. That is Jurriaan Maessen, and he's here to discuss the Bilderberg Group, the larger population reduction agenda, and more. He joins us from the Netherlands. Thanks for joining us, Jurriaan.
Thanks for having me.
So we just broke the story today. It's up on InfoWars. Sources so far are indicating the meeting will most likely be held in Chantilly, Virginia, here in the United States. It's been 4 years. They, of course, split their meetings between Europe and the United States. We'll follow up on that source to see if it is the true location, because they do a lot of bait and switching and deception, but it is a very likely spot. So with that, let's talk about the upcoming Bilderberg Group meeting and what their agenda is likely to be.
Their agenda is likely to be a continuation, I think, of the agenda we already know. That's population reduction, a large part of that. And to get this done, the entire economical, political system has to be arranged in such a way that it facilitates such a massive reduction.
Absolutely. And of course, they have demography groups that meet every year. They have United Nations Population Fund groups that attend Bilderberg regularly. You've got the Rockefeller Foundation, who've really been the core driving the eugenics agenda over the past century. Now the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is a major player in pursuing that eugenics agenda. They don't attend every year, but they tend to attend every 1 to 2 to 3 years. So we're likely to see them there. A lot of the top tech giants come, as well as, of course, the heads of state and the office, you know, the officials in various departments as well from both Europe and the United States. And that's definitely something they have planned. Of course, Agenda 21 is back on the agenda this year because it's the 20-year anniversary of the summit in Rio, which is all about sustainable development, economic growth, greening everything. But it also is in a large component about population reduction. And we've got one of our staff members, John, just showed me earlier today how the President's Council on Sustainable Development here in the United States, set up for the Agenda 21, is not only pursuing sustainable development, but stabilizing the U.S. population. It's right here in writing, put into the agenda from Bill Clinton, as well as the elder George Bush. And that's just here in the U.S. They're openly doing it all across the rest of the world, particularly in the developing areas.
Right. They all seem to move in unison. All the arms of the scientific dictatorship now, you see it in every country. You see it almost simultaneously. That's not a coincidence, of course. That's pre-planned. Of course, the calls for deindustrialization of the developed world is also a theme that regularly comes up. And it's all being done under the under perfectly decent euphemisms, let's say, sustainability, save the planet and all that. We know from their own documents that's just euphemisms for mass death.
Yeah, and that's something to bring up, too. You've got the article yesterday. It's right here. Professor depicts blood depicting knife machine gun while talking population control. And this is a Professor John Gillibald from University College. He's an emeritus professor, and he's coined the term population matters. And the point he's trying to make is that, yes, these are euphemisms. He openly admits they use different terms as code for population control. And he's saying, just do away with the code. Let's come out in the open and tell people what we're doing. I've got another book here that goes along with that. It's the RAND Corporation's report on the origin and evolution of family planning programs in developing countries. And this is eugenics. They've changed the name dozens of times over the year, over the years. After World War II, it became population control. That became a buzzword that people learned to avoid. So they came up with these other terms, reproductive health, women's issues, sustainable development, and on and on. They've literally coined these terms every couple of years at United Nations meetings. So please get into that and the details of your article.
Yes, this Gillibald fellow, he's actually quoted as saying, while showing a depiction of a blood-dripping knife and a machine gun, he said, please don't say population control. That's what he literally said. Say any other thing. Use my phrase, population matters. So that's a nice little tinkling. But never say population control. That's what he said. Then there was this gentleman over in a 2006 gathering organized by the German Development Bank. Present were the United Nations Population Fund and all the other usual suspects, World Bank, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, of course, where this professor of medical demography at the London School of Hygiene, John Cleland, indeed admitted that all modern-day language used in relation to this agenda they seek to pursue is actually code. No more shrouding our statements in code. That's what he said. Because code just confuses people. Very interesting, because it's all euphemism, and here he actually admits to it.
And you also point out it's what they call a thinly veiled threat. They say, quote, reduce human population numbers voluntarily or else. That's actually your summation of it. But it is this open threat, and it corresponds with images we've been shown, particularly in climate change propaganda, where you see the teacher pushing the red button and it blows up children who don't want to go along with curbing their carbon footprint, and so on and so forth. We've seen dozens, if not hundreds, of these examples. And they're telling us covertly in the propaganda and the media, they want to kill us, that our life is invaluable, that they want to save the earth by reining in the population numbers. But they also tell us, go along with our agenda and everything will be all right.
Right, trying to scare us into this submission or submissive state where we will just accept about anything. And that's the entire thing. They resort to these kind of tactics, and that means they have a weakness. And this weakness by the elite is they know that a lot of people, despite all the propaganda for the last decades, still have an instinctive resistance to all this massive propaganda going on. So I think this is also a good sign in a way that they just use open death threats towards mankind. That's because they know we only by death threats they may have a chance.
And if you've studied this stuff in depth, as you and I have and many others in our audience have, how could you go along with it knowing that they brag about spiking the vaccines, brag about putting poisons in the foods and developing GMO strains that are at the very least dangerous? We covered earlier today how several years ago, back in 2002, they were open air experimenting with experimental vaccines, strains of what was to become an AIDS virus, blood clotting agents, on and on, all kinds of very potentially dangerous stuff that they were growing in America's Midwest Corn Belt, where they grow the food for our country and much of the rest of the world. And the possibilities for open air contamination are right there. And it's just another suggestion of how where this road could lead, really.
Right, I think, and then we all have the UN to thank for this agenda going on right now, because it's of course Codex Alimentarius in action. We see that in the crops. We see it in the vaccines, with the help of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, especially in the third world, which the eugenicists and the elite right now want to begin by depopulating for a large part, because they know that the West is a little bit more challenging for them. Indeed, we see all these arms moving in the same direction, attempting to, I think, reduce our fertility in first instance, but it's actually, of course, for death.
I want to go back to the Bilderberg Group and the larger eugenics agenda. Of course, eugenics, the proper term for it, started in the late 1800s under the circles around T.H. Huxley, of course, Sir Francis Galton, and his cousin Darwin. And they brought that to light. It became very popular in the West, especially in the United States. It's very popular in Germany, which later developed into Nazi Germany eugenics. It was very popular in the Netherlands and the rest of Europe, and really across the Western world. As that developed, you also see simultaneously the cartel, IG Farben, out of the Nazi regime, and their secret partnership with the United States, with the Netherlands in particular. How did those factions come to form what we know as the Bilderberg Group? What's the role of people like Prince Bernhard, admittedly one of the founders of Bilderberg, as well as environmental groups, the World Wildlife Fund, and the other clubs you've mentioned, the 1001 Club and so forth and so on?
I think that the Second World War, which was in essence, of course, brought into being with the aim of creating two separate blocs, which is the United States on the one hand, the West on the one hand, and the East on the other, is also is of course the illusion of a war or a battle in which they can sustain their policies. You need fear to sustain these policies of mass population reduction, and you need to do it incrementally. And I think the Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands setting up this Bilderberg meeting officially repair or relations with the United States and Europe, but actually to form a group that could make policy in full impunity, pursuing their agenda. And of course, it's the Saxe Coburg Gotha family involved in this. So you see, involved in all these meetings are people of the European royal elite. Those are the people with enormous amounts of resources, land also. People forget about that sometimes, but they have such an enormous amount of land that they actually wanted to call the shots inside a unofficial group. I think that's the Bilderberg group. The real reason behind it is population control.
And what do you find in your research with the phony environmental movements, particularly World Wildlife Group, among others?
Well, you have that, what was it, Earth Hour? Earth Hour was this this sign that everybody should, put out the lights, dim the lights for the Earth. And the World Wildlife Fund, the same here. It was also founded by Bernhard on the one hand and Julian Huxley on the other. He was co-founder of the World Wildlife Fund.
Again, back to the heart of eugenics. Yeah, go ahead.
Right. He is the eugenicist of the 20th century. And he, of course, himself was an heir to the older eugenicists, Galton type characters. So you see this genealogy of sociopaths running things, having the resources for it. And they set up this World Wildlife Fund to really invade the continent of Africa in first instance, under the pretext of wanting to save wildlife, wanting to save the earth, wanting to help the people there. But actually what they did was capture the resources of the continent. I just recently wrote an article about that. So it's very sickening.
Yeah, just to dovetail, of course, one of the other founders, Prince Philip of Saxe Coburg Gotha, who said he wants to come back to Earth as a virus to lower human population level, another World Wildlife Fund initiator. And as you mentioned, it's land grabbing and it's population reduction in combination, which goes along perfectly with the Agenda 21 for sustainable development, coined, of course, 20 years ago under the United Nations and still being pursued very actively today. And all this continues because under the presidency of Obama, you've got John P. Holdren, who is himself a successor to decades and decades of covert eugenics, covert population reduction, and this larger land grab under the United Nations. Julian Huxley, who you mentioned, not only is a eugenicist, third generation eugenicist at that, and part of a larger family breeding program, but he wanted to specifically fuse in a kind of alchemical way the West with the particularly Soviet-led East into the world government. That's his theory in his 1946 document, UNESCO, Its Purpose and Philosophy. He really talks about fusing those systems together, developing the education and the culture and the science under his umbrella at UNESCO.
Right, and using the state as the engine to make sure these policies will be executed. So that's why the Soviet system was worked perfectly fine, just like China does right now, because it works on a collectivistic basis, and people are used to that over there. And now they have to get used to all these new environmental friendly policies, this virtuous green road. Which was described by a UN thinker in the early 90s, calling it a virtuous green road, while all the documents are definitely pointing to one agenda, which has an aim of reducing population, reducing fertility, and to do it incrementally. So it's a very smart and sophisticated thing, which we have to constantly investigate.
Incremental is the key word. Let's get into a little bit the Fabian Socialists, because that's the group that includes both Huxley brothers, Aldous Huxley, author of Brave New World, Julian Huxley of UNESCO, George Orwell was once in that group, H.G. Wells was in that group, and a lot of other very famous, very prominent writers who all wanted this progressive, long-term, 100-year increment for socialism. That's apparently why George Orwell named his novel 1984. It was the 100-year anniversary of the 1884 founding of the Fabian Socialists, and many people don't know they went from their core place in Britain over to Soviet Russia, studied their system, applauded what they were doing, and they came back, according to the founder of the Royal Institute of International Affairs, Alfred Toynbee, and said, this is our new Ten Commandments. This is what Moses came down from the mountain with from God. We have the 10 planks of communism. We want this, but we want it slowly so no one will stop it. No one will notice what's going on. And that's what you see in a larger pattern under the United Nations, a form of acclimating the whole world to a world government system.
Right, and it's actually more than just communism or socialism in the Marxist sense. That's just a theory, but the UN is above these differences of communism and capitalism, creating them in fact. So there's nothing to do with class warfare, this Fabian socialist society. It has everything to do with elitism.
The wolves in sheep's clothing. You're totally right. Go ahead.
Yeah, that's right. I couldn't agree more.
Well, we've got a lot of the same research. That's why it's easy to agree. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, that's fine. That's fine, because, that's all about to say. It's wolves in sheep clothing. That's it. And they have this agenda for such a long time that it's all written down. That right now we have to move forward, I think, to a next level of just beating these people at every turn. Every time they put out a new report, put out a new, a working paper or something, we just have to report on this constantly. Everybody should do this. Everybody who feels impulse to do this. Start your own blog and just write about this, because we need so much more people involved in this fight.
Well, in closing, looking ahead to the upcoming Bilderberg conference, if the location's wrong, we're going to correct that, of course. But whether it's in the U.S. or Europe, we have seen this year a great coalescing around the global warming climate change agenda, realizing that's falling apart on its scientific merits and its political drive and so forth. They've been more and more out in the open, moving towards just it's for population reduction. Have you seen this as well?
Yes, just lately, I think the last year or so, they started over from personal carbon quotas and all that, just to saying we need just global carbon cops and all that. This was Earth Summit 2012 promoters calling for global implementation of personal carbon quotas, but they also called, and that's very disturbing, securing commitments from governments to try to stabilize global population. That's the quote. Stabilize the global population. They want an international court for the environment to settle disputes. Which means you can go to jail because your carbon footprint is a little bit too big. This echoes the death threat made by the use of this commercial with children. So this is just off the chart madness.
Well, I think you hit it on the nail on the head. It's elitist coming out from their hiding in sheep's clothing and saying, we're going to kill you if you don't go along with our agenda, so you better go along with it. Just kidding, we're sheep, we're not really wolves, and we're doing this for everyone's good, and it's to save the earth. But if you don't go along with it, you're next. Well, anyway, right. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, it's a very dark energy we see, we feel from these people emanating from them. So we all have to step up a little bit, I think, everybody looking just to fight these people.
Well, we appreciate you joining us, Jurriaan. Of course, we'll look to your research in the future. Your articles are at Infowars.com, and are they on one of your blogs as well?
I don't even have a blog yet, but I do write a lot. So I still have to build a blog. I'm in the process of doing that right now.
Okay, well, we'll look forward to your reports in the future. Thanks again for joining us. That's it for tonight's InfoWars Nightly News. We'll be back again tomorrow with Darren McBreen. Stay tuned, and thanks for watching. Spread the word. Don't forget to subscribe at PrisonPlanet.tv. Help us fund our fight against the controlled media, against the globalists, and against their larger agenda.